Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killing Hitler, The Plots, The Assassins, and The Dictator Who Cheated Death, by Roger Moorhouse, narrated by James Cameron Stewart. Introduction. I might be killed by a criminal or by an idiot at any time. Adolf Hitler. Assassination, it was once said, has never changed the history of the world. This benign sentiment, often repeated in times of crisis, is wishful nonsense, however. In response, one might point most obviously to the killing of Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo, which unleashed the First World War, or to the murder of Sergei Kirov in 1934, which sparked the murderous purges in Stalin's Soviet Union. Assassination clearly has the capacity to affect world events. More recently, the question of the utility of assassination as a political weapon has been subjected to closer examination. An analysis of 18 famous assassinations through the ages concluded that not one of them achieved their wider political aims. Indeed, in many cases, the results were the exact opposite of those intended. The murder of President Lincoln in 1865, for example, by a Southern sympathizer, proved disastrous for the American South, while the assassination of Lord Cavendish by Irish nationalists in 1882 set the cause of Irish independence back by a generation. Assassinations, therefore, have certainly changed history. They have just never changed it in the way foreseen by the assassin. Yet the possibility that Hitler could have been assassinated is one that has tantalized historians and fiction writers alike. It is tempting to speculate not only on the number of lives that could have been saved, the conflict that might have been avoided, and the suffering that perhaps would have been spared, but also on how differently European and especially German history might have played out in the 20th century had Hitler been successfully felled by an assassin's bullet. Surely here, if nowhere else, is a case where an assassination might actually have brought the benefits intended by the assassin. The majority of modern listeners would probably agree, instinctively at least, with that statement. But it is interesting to note that unanimity on this issue was much harder to find during Hitler's lifetime. Then, discussions raged over the propriety of playing God, the setting of dangerous precedents, the thorny concepts of principled treachery and state-sanctioned terrorism, and the question of what further horrors might have followed Hitler's premature demise. Surprisingly, perhaps, the proposal to assassinate Hitler was never anything less than highly controversial. Yet, for all these concerns, Hitler's would-be assassins were not dissuaded. Few leaders of any century can have been the target of so many assassination attempts, no fewer than 42 separate plots on Hitler's life have been identified by German historians, and even that list is far from complete. Of these, around 20 can be considered serious enough to warrant the attention given to them here. Hitler was probably the most influential individual of the 20th century. His name has become synonymous with brutality, intolerance, and racial hatred. His face, perhaps the most instantly recognizable and iconic image of the modern era, is one that few, even those blessed with living in peaceful times, will ever forget. Yet what of his would-be assassins? In some cases, the assassin and his victim are bound together in perpetuity by their moment of shared history. Thus, John F. Kennedy has his Lee Harvey Oswald, Abraham Lincoln has his John Wilkes Booth, and Franz Ferdinand has his Gavrilo Princip. The assassins of history are sometimes lauded as heroes and are often vilified as the most bestial of criminals, but they are rarely forgotten. Yet Hitler's would-be assassins are, for the most part, unknown. Of them, Only the name Klaus von Stauffenberg might expect to register any reaction from the reading public. For all of them, of course, their greatest failing was that they were unable to carry out their allotted task, that of ridding the world of Adolf Hitler, but they nonetheless deserve greater recognition. They deserve better than to exist only in the footnotes of history, better than the obscurity to which they have been condemned by time and fashion, and in many cases by their Nazi executioners. Hitler's assassins ranged from simple craftsmen to high-ranking soldiers, from the apolitical to the ideologically obsessed, and from enemy agents to his closest associates. Inexplicably, few of these men are known beyond the narrow confines of academic history. Their deeds would elicit scarcely a flicker of recognition from the general listener. This is their story. It is the story of their plans, their motives, and, inevitably, their failures. But it is also an account of the remarkable survival of a tyrant. Prologue. Munich, Thursday, 8th November 1923, 8:30 p.m. Few of the guests would have noticed the sallow-faced young man who entered the beer hall that evening. All of the great and the good of Munich were there, bankers, businessmen, newspaper editors, and politicians. They had gathered to hear an address commemorating the fifth anniversary of the November Revolution, given by the newly appointed State Commissioner for Bavaria. They had expected a forceful denunciation of Marxism, an explanation of the administration's policies, perhaps even the advocacy of a restoration of the Bavarian monarchy. What they got was an attempted revolution. The hall, the Bürgerbräukeller, was one of the largest in Munich. Located on the east side of the river Isar, which bisected the city, it was a cavernous room that belied the cozy image of the traditional beer hall. With a high ceiling, ornate chandeliers, and a wide balcony running down one side, it could accommodate around 3,000 people seated on either side of long wooden trestle tables. As such, it was one of the primary venues in Munich for public lectures and political meetings. This evening, it was packed to the rafters. The doors had been closed already at 7:15 p.m. to prevent overcrowding, and the disappointed milled in the drizzle on the street outside. The man loitering at the rear of the hall would have been known to many of the guests present that night. A pale individual in his mid-30s, with sharp cheekbones, a toothbrush moustache, and striking blue eyes, Adolf Hitler was the leader of a local extreme nationalist group that called itself the National Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazis for short. He was renowned as a talented and inspirational public speaker, captivating his audiences with his impassioned and intemperate lectures on German politics. He had already spoken at the Bürgerbräukeller numerous times. This evening, however, he had come as an unlikely revolutionary. Dressed in a poorly cut black morning suit with flowing tails, his hair slicked close to his scalp and falling in unruly strands across his forehead, he looked more like an overworked waiter or an undertaker. Nonetheless, about half an hour into the keynote speech, he began to make his way forward at the head of a phalanx of fellow putschists. As a detachment of Nazi stormtroopers appeared, dragging a machine gun into the hall entrance, the distinguished speaker on the podium tailed off into silence. Whispers spread around the cavernous hall, drinkers craned their necks to see what was going on, women fainted, and tables were upended. In the commotion, Hitler clambered onto a chair, fired a pistol shot into the ceiling, and called for silence. "The National Revolution," he announced, "has begun." After a brief speech, he posted his troops and bodyguards at the exits and persuaded three of the honoured guests present, who between them effectively ruled Munich, to retire with him to an adjoining room. There, in wild excitement, Hitler harangued his captive audience, announcing the formation of a new government with himself at its head and promising ministerial posts for those present if they agreed to cooperate. Waving his gun, he warned melodramatically, "I have 4 shots in my pistol, 3 for my collaborators if they abandon me, the last is for myself." With that, he put the gun to his temple, declaring, "If I am not victorious by tomorrow afternoon, I shall be a dead man." Germany in 1923 had endured 5 years of chaos. Emerging from defeat in the maelstrom of World War I, its fledgling democracy was assailed from both left and right and undermined by a disintegrating economy. Political radicalism was fueled by a spiral of debilitating hyperinflation. By 1920, the price index stood at nearly 15 times its value in 1913. 2 years later, it was approaching 350. 1923 was to be a crisis year. In the West, the French occupied the Ruhr in response to the German non-payment of reparations, sparking passive resistance, strikes, and hunger riots. Elsewhere, disgruntled army units mutinied at Köstrin, east of Berlin, and in the subsequent months, pro-communist governments were established in Saxony and Thuringia. For a time, the instability appeared to be terminal, and all the while, the economy was heading into freefall. Prices in January 1923 were more than 2,500 times higher than they had been in 1913. By December, they were 1.25 billion times higher. The hyperinflation had become a full-scale currency collapse. The humble loaf of bread could cost over 400 billion marks, and many households found it more economical to burn money than attempt to use it to buy kindling or coal. Most Germans faced financial ruin. The situation in Bavaria was no less fraught. There, the upheaval of the previous few years had awakened thoughts of separatism. The regional government in Munich was already ploughing its own furrow, ignoring Berlin's strictures when it chose to, and tolerating the radical right. Indeed, the 2 power bases in the province, the monarchist old right of the government and the revolutionary new right of Hitler and his allies, existed in a curiously symbiotic relationship. Both held the government in Berlin in contempt and were keen to cooperate in their intrigues against it. Both, too, were impatient to raise the standard of revolt. However, their visions of the would-be revolution differed widely. Put simply, the old right wanted to create an independent Bavarian government, while the new right wanted to replace the Reich government. One wanted to defect from Berlin, and the other wanted to march on it. In the Bürgerbräukeller that evening, Hitler appeared finally to have succeeded in persuading Munich's ruling triumvirate to join in his vision of a revolution. About an hour after he had entered the hall, he returned to the podium, accompanied by his new confederates and the freshly arrived former army quartermaster, General Ludendorff. All 5 shook hands repeatedly and made short speeches to the assembled throng, announcing their new roles and their earnest intentions to cooperate. As they finished, the crowd, enthused by what they had heard, broke into an impromptu rendition of Deutschland über alles. One eyewitness recalled that the crowd had been turned inside out by Hitler's words, and that it had almost something of hocus-pocus about it. Ominously, Rudolf Hess, Hitler's secretary, then began calling names from a list of those present who were to be detained for interrogation and trial. With that, the remainder of the audience was allowed to leave, while sympathizers began arriving from around the city. Hitler, it appeared, had succeeded. Beyond the confines of the beer hall, however, the putsch was proceeding less well. Troops loyal to Hitler had scored some early victories. They had been bolstered by the defection of the cadets of the infantry school and had succeeded in occupying the three main beer halls in Munich. Elsewhere, they had taken over the Bavarian War Ministry and the offices of the influential Münchener Post newspaper. But as the night progressed, they achieved no more significant successes. Their own incompetence and the stiffened resolve of their opponents combined to prevent them from seizing other key buildings and barracks. Moreover, the authorities in Munich were preparing for a fight. The members of the ruling triumvirate, far from serving the putsch, had now repudiated it and were directing the resistance. The government, transferred to Regensburg for its own safety, had banned the morning newspapers and drafted in military reinforcements from the provinces. Across the city, its forces were now fully apprised of events and had specific orders on how the revolt was to be countered. As the would-be revolutionaries in the beer hall settled down for a long night, succoured by a generous supply of beer and bread rolls, they were still optimistic. In truth, they had already lost the initiative and now faced a precarious stalemate. The following day, as a cold dawn broke, the putschists finally recognized that their initial attempt to storm the bastions of power had failed. A British correspondent from the Times found his way to the Bürgerbräukeller that morning, where he discovered Ludendorff and Hitler in a small upstairs room. Hitler, he wrote, was dead tired and barely seemed to fill the part of the revolutionary. This little man in an old waterproof coat with a revolver at his hip, unshaven and with disordered hair, and so hoarse that he could scarcely speak. Ludendorff, in turn, was anxious and preoccupied. The putschists were considering their options. One suggested that the Bavarian crown prince could be induced to lend the revolt his support. Another proposed a tactical withdrawal to continue their resistance from the town of Rosenheim near the Austrian border. In the confusion, meanwhile, orders were delayed and further troops drifted away from their positions, considering their cause to be lost. By mid-morning, however, the idea of a demonstration march through the city was mooted. That way, the putschists besieged at the War Ministry could be relieved and the enthusiasm of the local population could be harnessed. The stalemate could be broken. After all, it was thought, the army would surely not turn its machine guns on Ludendorff, one of the most prominent generals of the First World War. The hotheads even considered that a march on Berlin could be attempted in imitation of Mussolini. "We would go into the city," Hitler later recalled, "to win the people to our side." Shortly before noon that morning, a column of around 2,000 men, armed and defiant, stepped out of the Bürgerbräukeller and headed for the center of the city. In the front rank, beneath the swastika banner and the flag of Imperial Germany, Hitler marched with Ludendorff on one side and his fellow conspirator Erwin von Scheubner-Richter on the other. Alongside them were Hitler's bodyguard, Ulrich Graf, a bull-necked apprentice butcher and amateur wrestler, the Nazi philosopher Gottfried Feder, and the leader of the stormtroopers, Hermann Göring, resplendent in a full-length leather coat with his Pour le Mérite, Germany's highest military award, visible at his throat. Behind them, the ranks of Hitler's security force, the Munich stormtroopers and the paramilitary Bund Oberland, marched four abreast, followed by a car bristling with weaponry. Bringing up the rear was a ragtag collection of students, tradesmen and fellow travellers, many inspired by the events of the previous night, many long-term disciples. Some marched smartly in uniform, some donned their medals from the Great War, and others shuffled along wearing work overalls. Jeered and cheered by a curious Munich public, the putschists moved steadily on, sustaining themselves by singing nationalist songs. Close to the river, they encountered their first serious obstacle when they confronted a police cordon on the Ludwigsbrücke. With bayonets levelled and exhortations to the policemen not to fire on their comrades, they swept the picket aside and continued unhindered across the bridge and into the heart of Munich. Proceeding through the Isartor, they came to the Marienplatz, where large crowds had gathered to watch events unfold. From there, they turned north in the direction of the Odeonsplatz, beyond which the War Ministry was located. As they approached the Feldherrnhalle, however, barely 50 metres from their target, they were confronted by a second, larger police presence. Linking arms, they advanced, some singing, some with bayonets at the ready, down the Residenzstrasse. This time, the police would not be brushed aside. As the two forces met, a shot rang out and the police opened fire. In the chaos, as a brief firefight ensued, the front rank of putschists fell to the ground, while the remainder fled. After a couple of minutes, only the dead and wounded remained. Göring had been shot in the groin. Schäubner Richter, to Hitler's left, fell mortally wounded with a bullet in the chest. Grave, who had shielded Hitler from the onslaught, took numerous bullets and was gravely injured. 4 Munich policemen had been killed, as well as a further 13 of Hitler's followers. The youngest of them, Karl Laforce, was barely 19. Hitler, meanwhile, had fallen in the melee, believing himself to have been shot. In fact, though wild rumours quickly circulated that he had been killed, he had merely suffered a dislocated shoulder from being violently pulled to the ground by the dying Schäubner Richter. In the aftermath, he struggled to his feet and found his way to a nearby square, where supporters spirited him to a waiting car and south toward Austria. Later that day, after an eventful escape from Munich, he arrived at the house of his fellow putschist Ernst Putzi Hanfstengel in Uffing, where he was tended by a sympathetic doctor. 2 days later, in the early evening of the 11th of November, the police finally tracked him down. According to one account, Hitler broke down when he heard of the police's arrival. With a cry of, "Now all is lost," he reached for his pistol. Yet, rather than turn the gun on himself, as he had promised to do at the Bürgerbräukeller, Hitler submitted meekly. The arresting officer found him in a bedroom, dressed in pyjamas, waiting calmly in sullen silence. Hitler had escaped death, but had nonetheless failed. His national revolution had been crushed, his party outlawed, and his loyal henchmen killed, arrested, or in exile. Tried for high treason the following spring, he was sentenced to 5 years' detention in the fortress at Landsberg. Contemporary opinion concluded that the name of Adolf Hitler had been a footnote in history, a chimera, soon to rank alongside countless other crackpots, radicals, and failed revolutionaries. He was haughtily dismissed by the Times as a house decorator and demagogue. Many took to speaking of him only in the past tense. The author Stefan Zweig, for example, considered that Hitler had fallen back into oblivion. Hitler himself was immune to such prophecies, for he considered himself to be subject to another, higher calling. "You may pronounce us guilty 1,000 times over," he railed to the state prosecutor at his trial, "but the goddess of the eternal court of history will smile and tear to tatters the sentence of this court." The bullets of the Bavarian police that had routed his forces in Munich had also given him his first brush with providence. He emerged from that experience and from his imprisonment at Landsberg with the unshakable belief that his life had been preserved so that he might fulfill a historic destiny to save Germany. He emerged as a man with a mission. Chapter 1. God's Assassin, Maurice Bavaud. One day, a completely harmless man will establish himself in an attic flat along the Wilhelmstrasse. He will be taken for a retired schoolmaster. A solid citizen, with horn-rimmed spectacles, poorly shaven, bearded. He will not allow anyone into his modest room. Here he will install a gun, quietly and without undue haste, and with uncanny patience he will aim it at the Reich Chancellery balcony, hour after hour, day after day. And then, one day, he will fire. Adolf Hitler. Shortly before noon, on the wintry morning of the 30th of January 1933, the leader of the Nazi Party, Adolf Hitler, was ushered into a meeting with the German President, Field Marshal Paul von Hindenburg. Accompanied by the members of his new cabinet, he was received frostily by the President, who was irritated at being kept waiting and was dubious about Hitler's appointment. Hindenburg grunted a perfunctory welcome and expressed his pleasure that the nationalist right had finally overcome its differences. He then proceeded to the matter in hand. Hitler was to be sworn in as Chancellor of the German Republic. Dressed in a sober dark suit and tie, Hitler solemnly swore to uphold the Constitution, to carry out his obligations without party bias, and to serve for the good of the entire German nation. In a short, unscheduled speech, he then promised to defend the rights of the President and to return to parliamentary rule after the next election. Hindenburg was less than loquacious in response. "And now, gentlemen," he intoned, "forward with God." That afternoon, the new cabinet sat for the German press in the Reich Chancellery. Hitler, seated in a generously upholstered chair, was surrounded by his new cabinet colleagues, with Goering seated to his right and von Papen, the kingmaker and vice-chancellor, to his left. The remainder stood behind the trio, looking distinctly uncomfortable. Little of the expected camaraderie was on show. Though they knew one another well, few of them made eye contact. Ministers stared sternly ahead or off to either side. Only Hitler allowed himself a broad smile. In his first public proclamation as Chancellor, he congratulated his followers on their great political triumph. In truth, Hitler's ascent to power was less glorious than his propagandists would later proclaim. Though the head of the party with the largest share of the popular vote, he was not appointed as a result of due democratic process. Rather, he was levered into power by the political elites in a grubby backstairs intrigue. Power had not been seized, it had been handed to Hitler like a poisoned chalice. Hitler, it was thought, would swiftly embarrass himself and discredit his movement, and if by some miracle he did not, he would lend the establishment his popularity in the country, while they, in turn, would endeavour to control him and rein in his wilder ambitions. To this end, Hitler was appointed the head of a government containing only a minority of Nazis. Of 11 posts, just 3 were held by his men: the chancellorship, the Ministry of the Interior, and a ministry without portfolio. Beyond these, all the most important government positions had gone to the Conservatives, thereby strengthening their belief that they could, between them, hold the rabble-rouser Hitler in check. Despite these restraints on Hitler's freedom of action, his appointment was still deeply unpopular among his new colleagues, and a number of additional concessions had been wrung out of him. For one thing, he had sworn to leave the cabinet unaltered regardless of the result of the elections he planned to hold. For another, he had made an empty promise to broaden the basis of his new government by approaching the centrist parties. It looked very much as though the conservative ruse had succeeded. Hitler appeared to have been laced into a political straitjacket. He would serve, it was hoped, as a popular figurehead, but wield little in the way of genuine power. For all these caveats, Hitler's victory was nonetheless substantial. The former corporal, beer hall agitator, and self-confessed drummer for the nationalist cause, had reached the pinnacle of political power. His followers, quite naturally, celebrated the success. Coordinated by Goebbels, the Sturmabteilung and Schutzstaffel of the capital congregated at the Tiergarten in preparation for an impromptu victory parade. Armed with torches, they set off in the evening gloom at 7 p.m., heading for the government quarter. Marching 16 abreast to the thunderous acclaim of drums and military bands, they passed beneath the Brandenburg Gate and on into the Wilhelmstrasse, where they stopped to salute the aged president. Proceeding to Hitler's new residence at the Reich Chancellery, they broke into a chorus of Sieg Heil as they were greeted by the new chancellor from a first-floor window. Goebbels confided to his diary that it was just like a fairy tale. Hitler's new exalted status brought with it new requirements for his security regime. For one thing, his appointment was a profound shock to all those who had considered him and his movement to be a passing phase, or even faintly ridiculous. It caused his opponents, passive and active alike, to sit up and take notice of him, and to consider what action might be taken in response. Hitler's moment of triumph was arguably his moment of greatest vulnerability. As Chancellor, Hitler became heir to a surprisingly violent tradition of assassination plots. The famous 19th-century Chancellor Otto von Bismarck had escaped two such attempts, and the volatile years after World War I had seen a spate of political murders, culminating in the assassination of the foreign minister, Walter Rathenau, in Berlin in the summer of 1922. In the aftermath of that attack, security for the Chancellor and his ministers was placed on an entirely new footing. Whereas previously leading politicians would have been subject to only the most cursory of security measures, consisting of no more than a driver, an assistant, and perhaps a few policemen, they were now to be guarded much more closely. Barely 5 days after Rathenau's murder, new measures were being suggested and implemented. A second escort car was to accompany the Chancellor, for example, while security at the Reich Chancellery was thoroughly reorganized. All those who sent threatening or defamatory letters to ministers could expect to be investigated by the police. Any threats made were to be taken very seriously. Thanks to these measures, a number of plots were discovered in the years prior to Hitler's appointment. In the winter of 1922, for example, a Dresden merchant called Willy Schulze was found in possession of two pistols with which, he confessed, he intended to murder Chancellor Wirth. Some years later, in 1931, a crude explosive device addressed to Chancellor Brüning was intercepted by security staff. The following year, a female assailant was caught inside the Chancellery building armed with a 28-centimeter dagger. In spite of the improved security regime, she had succeeded in gaining entry through a side door and had reached the second floor of the building before being apprehended. The revised security apparatus clearly functioned, but with Hitler's appointment as Chancellor in 1933, it was to face its toughest challenge. For one so steeped in violence, it is perhaps no surprise that Hitler had a heightened sense of his own vulnerability to attack. Right from the outset of his political career, Hitler realized that he needed a bodyguard, a unit of unquestioned loyalty, a group of men who would even march against their own brothers. To this end, he employed a small coterie of toughs to serve as drivers, guards, and general factotums. This group was formed into the Saalschutz, Assembly Hall Protection, in 1920, which expanded to become the Sturmabteilung, SA, or Storm Detachment, the following year. Yet while the SA was responsible for security in the broadest sense of the term, the more finessed requirements of Hitler's personal safety were still handled by a small group of trusted men. These included the former wrestler Ulrich Grave, who served as Hitler's bodyguard, Emil Maurice, a former watchmaker and Freikorps veteran who was his driver, Christian Weber, a horse dealer and part-time pimp who was his secretary, his valet Julius Schaub, and his adjutant Wilhelm Bruckner. Between them, these men were initially responsible for Hitler's safety at public events and speaking engagements. They formed the Führer's innermost circle. In the crisis year of 1923, it was decided to reorganize Hitler's security. An elite guard was established, the Stabswache, staff guard, which was recruited from the ranks of the SA and was sworn to protect Hitler from both internal and external threats. When the Stabswache fell victim to internal SA squabbling, however, a new bodyguard was formed. The Storstrupp, assault squad, numbered about 100 individuals, but its core was still made up of Hitler's old informal bodyguards. Grave, Maurice, Weber, Bruckner, and Schaub were all members. They would receive their baptism of fire in the Munich putsch of November that year, when five of their number would be killed. In 1925, following Hitler's early release from prison, the Nazi Party and SA were refounded. The bodyguard was revived too. It was initially given its original title of Stabswache, but was then renamed the Schutzstaffel, the SS or Protection Squad. In contrast to the deliberate proletarianism of the SA, the SS was to be unashamedly elitist. Originally numbering only 8 men, it grew slowly as each party cell was obliged to provide an SS unit of no more than 10 men to provide for security. By the late 1920s, it numbered only around 280, in stark contrast to the 60,000-strong SA. SS applicants were strictly vetted and discipline was tight. Only the best and most reliable party members would be considered. They were to be efficient, resourceful, trustworthy, and above all, blindly devoted to Adolf Hitler. They would not participate in political discussions, but would attend meetings intended for political instruction. They would not smoke at party events, and would not leave the room until commanded to do so. Their motto was, "Meine Ehre heißt Treue," my honor is loyalty. The SS would remain a relatively small, even insignificant organization until the advent of Heinrich Himmler. In January 1928, Himmler assumed responsibility for the everyday running of the SS. A year later, he became its leader, the Reichsführer SS. Under his stewardship, the SS was expanded, its discipline was tightened even further, and its unquestioning loyalty to Hitler was trumpeted once again. Himmler wanted to inculcate into the SS the same extreme ethos that he claimed of himself. "If Hitler were to say, 'I should shoot my mother,'" he once boasted, "I would do it and be proud of his confidence." Thankfully, most of the tasks set for the SS were much more mundane, consisting of guarding the Brown House, the Nazi Party headquarters in Munich, and providing routine security. One veteran of the period described the unit's remit: "The SS was still a very small group, sifted from the SA with the purpose of protecting the party, especially the party leadership in public. I was at several of the larger rallies in Hamburg. It was our job to shield the podium, accompany the speakers to and from their cars, guard their hotel, and so on. Things would often get pretty lively." In stark contrast to the growing confidence of the SS, the SA was entering a period of crisis. By the late 1920s, the brown ranks of the SA had marched and fought and had propelled the Nazi Party into the front rank of German politics. But Hitler, who was now increasingly playing the respectable bourgeois politician, had become faintly embarrassed by his mob. The vanguard of his revolution, he believed, had become a dubious mass, politically unreliable and totally unpredictable. Moreover, given that the SA contained a majority of unemployed members in many districts, some units could not even raise enough money for the requisite swastikas, he feared that it was becoming far too interested in the socialist element of National Socialism. The party leadership, meanwhile, with its expensive cars and plush apartments, was widely seen by the SA as betraying its proletarian power base. The crunch came in 1931, when much of the SA was drawn into a revolt under their deputy leader, Walter Stennis. Though they were soon brought back into the fold, the event sounded the movement's death knell. Tellingly, the SS had remained scrupulously loyal to Hitler throughout. Thereafter, as the SA waned, the SS was ideally placed to take over sole responsibility for Hitler's security, and accordingly, Hitler's new personal bodyguard would be drawn exclusively from its ranks. Its first commander, Sepp Dietrich, was a blunt Bavarian, a veteran of the Freikorps and the Munich Putsch, who would become one of the most decorated SS generals of the Second World War. Dietrich, who had joined the SS in 1928, rose quickly within the Munich cadre, and within a year was a part of Hitler's inner circle and one of his unofficial bodyguards. As the political temperature rose in Germany, however, and the violence reached unprecedented levels, it soon became necessary to put Hitler's security on a more formal footing. In February 1932, Dietrich was requested to organize a permanent protection unit for the Führer. The result was the SS Begleitkommando der Führer, SS Escort Detachment. A contemporary described its men in vivid terms as fine, athletic German types. They had zipped motorcar overalls over their black-coated uniforms and wore close-fitting aviator's helmets. Armed with revolvers and shamboks, hippopotamus whips, they looked like men from Mars. Another eyewitness was less flattering, describing the Führer's bodyguards as strangely delicate, almost effeminate. Though he went on to wonder whether they might have been selected by the senior Nazi and notorious homosexual Ernst Röhm, he did at least concede, after spending an evening in their company, that they were tough, all right. Initially numbering only 12 men under the command of Dietrich, the bodyguard detachment was to accompany Hitler on the turbulent election campaigns of that year. An account by a British journalist described their modus operandi. In the spring of 1932, Hitler was campaigning in the East Prussian town of Elbing when his entourage was ambushed by communist protesters. As his driver swerved to avoid the mob, Hitler's leather-coated bodyguards had already leaped out of their car and were lashing out with rubber truncheons and blackjacks. Stones started to fly and pistol shots rang out. Then the men were back in their cars, and on we went. When he was resident in Munich, Hitler's security measures were more formal. His residence there, from 1931, was the so-called Brown House, an elegant three-story palace that had once served as the residence of the Italian emissary to the Bavarian royal court. The guard detail consisted of three shifts, each of 17 men drawn from the SS. Of these, at least 10 were stationed inside the building, while a further 6 guarded the entrance, the grounds, and the perimeter. Access to the building was permitted only upon production of a valid pass. It is, however, doubtful that the security in Munich was particularly effective. For one thing, prior to 1933, the guards on duty were forbidden to carry weapons. In addition, it does not appear that the measures instituted were always strictly followed. One British visitor to the Brown House, for example, recalled being barked at by the sentries not to walk on the pavement outside the building, but made no mention of encountering any security procedures once inside. The security methods employed by Hitler in 1932 were, in truth, much as they had been in 1923. He had a dedicated and fiercely loyal bodyguard at his disposal, but its efficacy was open to serious doubt. Part of the problem facing anyone attempting to create a credible security regime for Hitler was Hitler himself. The Führer's attitude to his own security was shot through with contradictions and inconsistencies. On one hand, he was almost obsessed with his own mortality. He viewed himself as the man of destiny, the man to lead Germany out of slavery. Yet his fragile constitution caused him to believe that his time was short. Hitler, in truth, was not a well man. It has long been conjectured that he may have suffered the effects of syphilis. But in addition to that phantom, he clearly felt the very real strains of political life. By 1936, he was complaining of a whole catalogue of ailments, including tinnitus, migraines, insomnia, eczema, stomach cramps, flatulence, and bleeding gums. To this list, one might add acute hypochondria. Hitler's concern for his own health peaked in May 1935, when he convinced himself that a polyp removed from his larynx would prove cancerous. From that point, he became a man in a hurry, politically speaking. As he confessed to an intimate, "I shall never become the old man of the Obersalzberg. I have so little time." In addition to all that, Hitler was preoccupied with the idea that he might fall victim to an assassin. Consequently, as he persistently impressed upon his bodyguards, his own survival was of paramount importance. He took an extraordinarily detailed interest in security measures and demanded that they be constantly updated and intensified. He regularly carried a pistol in public, and his personal bodyguards and adjutants were also invariably armed. Of course, Hitler's political activities inevitably exposed him to some considerable danger. As head of the most violent and aggressive movement in German political life, he naturally aroused the personal enmity of his opponents. But in campaigning, whether speaking before hostile audiences or merely travelling to political events, he was regularly obliged to confront his detractors. He was ambushed a number of times. Once, a train he was travelling on was attacked. Communists also took potshots at his car. On another occasion, in 1920, he escaped detection by a menacing mob only by posing as the Batman of one of his entourage. Only his, then, relative anonymity saved his skin. Yet, beyond what one might call necessary exposure to danger, Hitler also regularly and willfully undermined the efforts of his protectors. For one thing, he could be astonishingly reckless. Once, in the Black Forest city of Freiburg, when his car was pelted with stones, he jumped down from the vehicle, waving his whip, forcing his astonished attackers to scatter. On another occasion, Albert Speer described how Hitler's motorcade drove through hostile crowds in Berlin. The temper of the crowd grew ugly. When Hitler with his entourage arrived a few minutes later, the demonstrators overflowed into the street. Hitler's car had to force its way through at a snail's pace. Hitler stood erect beside the driver. At that time, I felt respect for his courage, and still do. Years later, Hitler would explain his actions. If an idealist assassin wanted to shoot him or blow him up, he opined, it would make little difference if he was sitting or standing. In the heroic days, he said, I shrank from nothing. Hitler was also utterly and deliberately unpredictable. Speer called him royally unreliable. His routine, insofar as it is worthy of the name, consisted of rising late and working long into the night, usually ranting to his minions. He was incapable of any systematic work, preferring to indulge his own whims or to submit to indolence. In addition, he would often disappear to spend the weekend with associates in Berlin or Munich, but would accept little in the way of forward planning. Though this pattern served as an effective hindrance to any potential assassin, it also did little to facilitate the work of his bodyguards. Indeed, for all his attention to security details, Hitler was fundamentally unconvinced that his bodyguards would actually serve any practical purpose. His belief in fate and destiny caused him to ascribe his continued survival not to the police, but to pure chance. Thus, though he paid painstaking attention to the details of his security regime, it is tempting to think that, in this case at least, he really was just playing at soldiers, reveling in his own supernatural importance, yet knowing in his heart that all such efforts would ultimately prove futile. On one level, Hitler's apparent nonchalance would appear to have been justified. In the early months of 1933, numerous accounts were received in Berlin of the wildest plots and conspiracies to kill the new Chancellor. They arrived from all parts: Switzerland, Holland, Morocco, Spain, Czechoslovakia, and the United States. Some overheard Jews plotting in Baal, others had wind of anarchists conspiring in Barcelona, still others heard of communists scheming in the Saarland. Most of the reports were flimsy, based on hearsay or a flippant comment such as, "Someone should bump that Hitler off." But some defied credibility entirely. One informant from Augsburg, for example, wrote to inform Hitler of the possibility that the Chancellery building itself might be undermined and that subversives might plant explosives there. Though the correspondent confessed to having no knowledge of such a plot, he exhorted his Führer to guard his precious life most carefully. As a result of such enthusiastic and imaginative informants, the Berlin police were alerted almost every week that a new plot was afoot. Most of the threats were investigated, but of the hundreds received, only about 10 were considered to warrant serious attention, and even these amounted to very little. One might have assumed that the greatest threat to the life of the new Chancellor came from the left. Certainly, Germany's socialists and communists were well aware that the new regime was likely to declare open season on them, and some were perhaps minded to prepare a preemptive strike. However, the German left was almost congenitally unable to rouse itself to target Hitler. The socialists were wedded to the democratic process and found such extreme measures hard to stomach, while the communists were being exhorted by their masters in Moscow to direct their efforts against the socialists. Beyond sheer myopia, much of their common problem was ideological. Marxist theory viewed fascism as the last gasp of the capitalist bourgeoisie, the bloody prelude to an inevitable socialist utopia. History, it was thought, was driven by grand social and economic forces, not by individuals. So, to many on the left, the elimination of Hitler made little sense. Nonetheless, a brave few were willing to give history a helping hand. One was Beppo Rumme, a communist and former Freikorps leader who gained access to the Chancellery in the spring of 1933, but was discovered by the SS. He would spend the next 6 years in Dachau and would cease conspiring against Hitler only when he was executed in 1942. Another was Kurt Luther, a communist shipwright from Königsberg, who plotted a bomb attack on Hitler in the spring of 1933. Arrested and interrogated, Luther was released without charge due to a lack of evidence. Later, in 1935, an ambitious communist conspiracy was uncovered in Vienna, which planned to assassinate Hitler as well as the Minister of War, General Blomberg, along with Göring, Goebbels, and Hess. Interestingly, the conspirators intended to give the impression that their plot had been hatched by the SA. In contrast to the largely latent threat from the left, that emanating from the disgruntled on the right appeared to be more serious. First, there were many within the SA who still viewed Hitler as a traitor to their principles. Some of the more prominent among them could be bought off after January 1933, but much of the rank and file was barely reconciled to the new constellation of power or to the apparent success of their Führer. Indeed, in 1933, a would-be assassin in SA uniform was arrested carrying a loaded weapon into Hitler's residence at Berchtesgaden. The SA crisis culminated in the Röhm purge in the summer of 1934. Yet, even while the SA was being purged and its supposed threat to the peace of the nation was being widely touted by Hitler, it momentarily found an opportunity to avenge itself. As Hitler and his SS entourage were preparing to leave the Bavarian guesthouse, where many of the SA leadership had been arrested, an SA bodyguard detachment arrived. Clearly confused and increasingly aggressive, they were ordered to return to barracks in Munich. However, they drove only a short distance before setting up a roadblock with machine guns on either side of the road to wait for Hitler. The Führer, meanwhile, had thought it wise to depart the area by another route. Another source of opposition to Hitler was the so-called Black Front, headed by the former Nazi Otto Strasser. Always on the fringe of the Nazi Party because of his eclectic ideology, a curious amalgam of extreme nationalism, anti-capitalism, socialism, and anarchism, Strasser was forced out of the party in the summer of 1930. He conceived the Black Front as an umbrella organization for all those on the right who were disaffected with Hitler, and by the time of the movement's prohibition in January 1933, it had attracted some 5,000 members. Thereafter, based in Vienna and then Prague, Strasser fought a propaganda campaign against Hitler and maintained a small underground network within Germany itself. His most audacious move came in 1936, when he planned to assassinate Hitler. His chosen assassin was a Jewish student from Stuttgart, Helmut Hirsch, who was studying architecture in Prague and was persuaded to carry out a heroic act to inspire the Jews of Germany. Hirsch was to take a suitcase bomb to the Nazi Party headquarters in Nuremberg, but was arrested on crossing the German frontier in December 1936 and executed the following spring. Two theories might explain his failure. Either the Gestapo had an informant within the Black Front, or else the Black Front had cynically betrayed Hirsch itself so as to benefit from the attendant publicity. Yet Hirsch was symbolic of another growing source of resistance to Hitler. Organized Jewish opposition to Nazism only really sparked into life with the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising of 1943. Until that point, the growing persecution of Jews within Germany and elsewhere was met with an almost stereotypically phlegmatic response. Some individuals, however, were goaded into action. Hirsch, for example, had been frustrated by his family's vain efforts to secure American citizenship. He may also have been spurred by the actions of a young Yugoslav Jew, David Frankfurter, who in February 1936 had successfully carried out a near-perfect assassination. Frankfurter was a failed medical student who had fled to Switzerland after briefly attending Frankfurt University. In exile, he read reports of the concentration camps and anti-Jewish propaganda and was spurred to act. He had initially wanted to target Hitler, but had settled on the German-born Swiss Nazi leader Wilhelm Gustloff. Frankfurter did his homework. He studied Gustloff's routine, memorized his movements, and carried his photograph to aid identification. He also bought himself a revolver and practiced on a shooting range in Bern. On the 3rd of February, he purchased a one-way ticket to Davos, where he rented a room. The following day, he went to Gustloff's house, calmly rang the doorbell, and asked to see his target. He was ushered into a study, seated beneath a picture of Adolf Hitler, and asked to wait. When Gustloff entered the room, Frankfurter shot him 5 times in the chest and head before fleeing the scene and telephoning the police. He surrendered himself with the words, "I fired the shots because I am a Jew. I am fully aware of what I have done and have no regrets." Like Hirsch, Frankfurter was seeking to spur his tormented people to resistance against the Nazis. Like Hirsch, he failed in this wider aim. While organized Jewish resistance was still absent, however, Hirsch and Frankfurter demonstrated that individuals could be provoked into action by their repeated humiliations and privations, and in such circumstances, they required few means beyond the humble accoutrements of the lone assassin. Their example would be followed once again with horrific results in 1938. That November, the secretary of the German legation in Paris was murdered by a 17-year-old Polish Jew, Herschel Grishpan, whose family had been expelled from the Reich. Grishpan was caught and subsequently killed by the Nazis, but his crime would provide the cue for the murderous pogrom of Kristallnacht. Jewish resistance appeared to have scored a spectacular own goal, but it had at least demonstrated what was possible. Following Hitler's accession to power in January 1933, and in view of the increased threat that the new Chancellor was considered to be under, yet another revision of his personal security was carried out. For the first time, the Führer's protection could command state funding, and those surrounding Hitler wasted little time in exploiting the new situation for their own ends, creating power bases and seeking to exert influence. The foremost among them was Heinrich Himmler. In March 1933, soon after the Nazi seizure of power, Himmler established a new security body to operate in parallel to those already existing. He envisaged the new unit, christened the Führerschutzkommando, Führer Protection Group, as a small group of tried and trusted National Socialists and excellent criminal police officers that would guarantee Hitler's unconditional safety, exercise conscientiousness, and show exemplary manners. This move would naturally serve to expand Himmler's growing influence and bring him closer to the epicenter of power. But it was also seriously flawed. First, officially at least, Himmler's own writ, and by extension that of his pet organizations, did not yet carry Germany-wide. His Führer Protection Group, therefore, could initially protect the Führer only in Bavaria. Moreover, the unit was made up almost exclusively of Bavarian policemen, the very officers who had put down Hitler's abortive putsch a decade before. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Hitler initially refused to be guarded by anyone other than the trusted Leibstandarter Adolf Hitler, Adolf Hitler bodyguard, which had been established by Sepp Dietrich a few months before. The Leibstandarter had in turn been developed in parallel to Dietrich's previous bodyguard unit, the SS Begleitkommando der Führer, which had been set up the previous year. It was to serve as a model SS unit and would absorb all previous security organs. Initially numbering only 120 individuals, it was composed solely of the German elite, those with proven Aryan ancestry, Nordic in appearance, possessing no criminal record and having a minimum height of 1.80 meters, 5 feet 11 inches. One is tempted here to recall the contemporary Polish line, "As tall as Hitler, lean as Göring, blonde as Himmler, and athletic as Goebbels." The first detachment of the Leibstandarte to assume its post was a detail of 12 men assigned to guard the Reich Chancellery in April 1933. A second unit was sent to Berchtesgaden that July. By November, the entire Leibstandarte, now over 800 strong, swore an oath of allegiance to Hitler before the memorial to the fallen of the Beer Hall Putsch. Their oath was a personal one, which made no mention of the Constitution or even of the German people. "I swear to you, Adolf Hitler, as Führer and Chancellor of the German Reich, loyalty and bravery. I vow to you and to my superiors appointed by you obedience unto death. So help me God." One witness recalled the scene with no little emotion. "The midnight oath-taking ceremony before the Feldherrnhalle in Munich. Splendid young men, serious of face, exemplary in bearing and turnout. An elite. Tears came to my eyes when, by the light of the torches, their voices repeated the oath in chorus. It was like a prayer." Already by this point, the Leibstandarte was engaged guarding the Reich Chancellery, Berlin's three airports, numerous ministries, Berchtesgaden, and Himmler's home. It was, of course, primarily a corps of bodyguards. As such, it excelled, not least in its very obvious manner. Its giant sentries, in their immaculate black uniforms with white belts and white gloves, were a gift to the propagandists. They inspired fear, respect, and envy in equal measure. One eyewitness recalled their impressive appearance in Breslau in 1938, where they remained unperturbed as a march threatened to descend into hysterical chaos. There was, however, one group that remained immune to the excitement spreading around them and stood fast in their positions with stoical ease. These were the Führer's bodyguards from the SS Adolf Hitler, gigantic men over 2 meters tall, wearing black uniforms and black steel helmets. They surrounded the rostrum and, at a sign from an officer, closed ranks. The Leibstandarte was, however, not just a corps of bodyguards. It was the elite troop of the elite SS, Hitler's household cavalry. Its men provided the guard of honor for visiting dignitaries. They paraded for Hitler's birthday and for the numerous other anniversaries in the Nazi calendar, with their famed marching band leading the chorus. But they also fulfilled a much more sinister function. They served as chief executioners during the Röhm purge and would attend every ceremonial entry as the Reich expanded. The Tsar in 1935, the Rhineland in 1936, Vienna in 1938, Prague and Warsaw in 1939, Paris in 1940. As their oath demonstrated, they were the beginnings of Hitler's private army. Despite the Leibstandarte's apparent position of strength, a new rival was to emerge in 1934. By that time, Himmler had expanded his own power base and had succeeded in pushing for a further review of Hitler's security apparatus. After much wrangling, he persuaded Hitler to appoint him chief of the newly formed Reichssicherheitsdienst, RSD, Reich Security Service, which would supersede the earlier Führerschutzkommando and would be responsible for the protection of Hitler and other prominent government figures. The RSD initially consisted of only 45 officers, divided into a number of bureaus, the first of which was assigned to protect the Führer. Its tasks included the routine surveillance of salient buildings, pre-event spot checks at venues, travel security, and the investigation of suspects. Wherever Hitler travelled within Germany, the RSD was granted authority over all local police forces for the duration of the visit. By the outbreak of war, the unit numbered over 200 officers. The fourth player in the pre-war security regime was the SS Begleitkommando, SS escort detachment established by Sepp Dietrich in 1932. With the seizure of power, the clique of old fighters, who had previously made up Hitler's entourage, were rewarded with various administrative postings, honorary positions, and sinecures. The SS escort detachment, therefore, effectively had to be refounded, and its new members, drawn from elsewhere in the SS, were strictly vetted. Initially numbering only about 8, it was charged with accompanying Hitler on all domestic and foreign trips. Those not on duty with the escort served as valets, drivers, and orderlies. Meanwhile, the tug of war for control of Hitler's security continued at the highest level. After Himmler's Führer Protection Group fell by the wayside, absorbed into the regular police and subordinated to the Ministry of the Interior, the remaining players, the RSD, the SS Escort Detachment, and the Leibstandarte, were forced to divide their labour sensibly. Where their remits overlapped, they had to establish discrete areas of competence. The solution was that the escort duties were undertaken by the SS Escort Detachment, bodyguards, ceremonial guards, and sentry details would be provided by the Leibstandarte, and the RSD would supply the professional police support, including surveillance and investigation. Between them, the three formed a formidable barrier to anyone who wished Adolf Hitler harm. An impression of the security surrounding the Führer can be gleaned from an examination of the procedures instituted in the Reich Chancellery in 1938. Any visitor to the building would have to pass through 2 SS sentry posts prior to entry. Then the visitor would be referred to a receptionist and issued an identification pass before receiving an SS escort to the relevant office. Thereafter, the visitor would pass the various sentries of the 39-strong permanent SS guard. On accessing the first floor, where the Führer's suite was located, the visitor would encounter a visibly stricter security presence with meticulous identity checks. Anyone without a valid pass was liable to arrest. Upon departure, the visitor would be escorted back to the reception area where the pass would be surrendered. In addition to all this, Hitler was also widely rumoured to have employed a double, although no documentary evidence supports this supposition. Hitler's transport arrangements were another obvious source of security concern. Hitler was an early enthusiast of the motor car. He had owned one as early as 1923, a red Mercedes, which was confiscated by the Munich police following the beer hall putsch. Thereafter, he acquired a string of vehicles, mainly Mercedes or Maybach, for his personal and political use. Following the seizure of power, he began to assemble a fleet of specially modified Mercedes, some of which were armor-plated with bulletproof tires and 5-centimeter-thick glass, and were supposedly impervious to bomb blasts and small arms fire. Despite its obvious shortcomings, however, Hitler's favored vehicle was an open-top tourer. Being seen was evidently more important to him than being safe. On public appearances, Hitler's car would usually form part of a convoy of at least 4 vehicles. A pilot car would lead the way, followed by Hitler's vehicle, with at least 2 more behind that, one carrying the SS Escort Detachment detail and another containing officers from the RSD. Elaborate routines were planned whereby the Führer's arrival could be effected while a security cordon was simultaneously thrown across the street. Any vehicle attempting to disrupt or infiltrate the convoy was to be rammed off the road. Occasionally, even starstruck pedestrians were run down. One pedestrian who was less than starstruck was the British military attaché Sir Noel Mason Macfarlane, who witnessed Hitler's convoy en route to Vienna in 1938. Near Linz, he pulled into a garage at a spot he heard that the Führer was due to pass. He recalled, "I decided to wait and see the arch thug pass. Only a few minutes later, a couple of Mercedes filled with SS, bristling with Tommy guns and other lethal weapons, came by. They were closely followed by half a dozen supercars containing Hitler and his immediate entourage and bodyguard. There was something terribly sinister about that string of shining black Mercedes rolling along inexorably towards Vienna. In addition to his fleet of Mercedes, the arch thug also kept a small fleet of airplanes. In the early 1930s, he had already made novel and extensive use of air travel in his political campaigning. This trend continued after 1933, when he appointed his pilot, Hans Bauer, to supervise the creation of a flying group. As well as using the ubiquitous workhorse, the Junker 52, Hitler also employed a modified Focke-Wulf Condor bearing the registration D2600 as his private plane. Security measures were especially tight. Only Bauer was permitted to pilot the plane, and he would never reveal the destination of a flight, even to airport officials. D2600 was kept in a secure hangar at Tempelhof Airport in Berlin, where it was guarded by a joint detail of RSD and Leibstandarte, and maintained by a strictly vetted team of engineers. Before every departure, it made a 15-minute test flight, and the carriage of parcels, mail, and unauthorized luggage was expressly forbidden. From 1937, Hitler also operated a personal train, the Führer Sonderzug, or Führer Special. Constructed almost entirely of reinforced steel, it consisted of a locomotive pulling a succession of as many as 15 cars and conference coaches. It had a permanent staff of over 60, including guards, adjutants, valets, and maintenance personnel. When on the move, the Führer Special was often preceded by a dummy train to attract any malicious intent. It was to be given priority at all times, and scheduled services were forbidden to overtake, while any following locomotive had to proceed after a 5-minute interval. Despite these measures, it was, of course, extremely difficult for the RSD to keep Hitler's train movements out of the public domain. Given the constraints of timetabling, any departure required a minimum of 2 hours' advance notice to the rail authorities to adjust timetables and minimize confusion. And in every case, word would inevitably be swiftly passed down the line to railway men, station masters, and beyond. For all its apparent effort and expense, Hitler's security regime suffered a number of fundamental flaws. Most important, there was a surprisingly lax attitude toward the vetting of staff in potentially sensitive positions. Few of the RSD members, for example, were initially Nazi Party supporters, and even the unit's commander, the rotund Bavarian Johann Hans Rattenhuber, only joined the party after his appointment. Among the Leibstandarte too, Nazi Party membership was apparently not a precondition, and over a quarter of the personnel were not paid-up members. Even among Hitler's inner circle, the same apparent laxity prevailed. One of Hitler's secretaries, Traudl Junger, owed her position not only to her stenographic skills, but also to her sister's relationship with Bormann's brother. Similarly, Hitler's cook, Marlene von Exner, was engaged solely on the strength of a personal recommendation from the Romanian dictator, Marshal Antonescu, and did not undergo any vetting procedure. Had she been of a mind to do so, Frau von Exner would have been ideally placed to poison Hitler. She was later dismissed when it was discovered that she had a Jewish grandmother. Albert Speer, who was to become one of Hitler's closest confidants, noted the almost complete lack of security checks for his first meeting with the Führer in the summer of 1933. Though an acquaintance of Goebbels and Rudolf Hess, Speer was still a virtual unknown. Yet when admitted to an interview with Hitler in his Nuremberg apartment, he was ushered in by an adjutant and stood alone before the mighty Chancellor of the German Reich. Security measures, if there were any, were not mentioned. In addition, it appears that some of Hitler's guards did not treat their positions with the conscientiousness that one might have expected. In one instance, a formal complaint was forwarded to Sepp Dietrich after Leibstandarte men were caught riding in the Reich Chancellery lift. Another of Dietrich's men was reprimanded for pressing his nose against the ground floor windows when on duty. More seriously, weapons were inadvertently discharged within the complex on a number of occasions. The bodyguards themselves described their efforts as insufficient, even amateurish. One veteran of the Leibstandarte recalled that they were given no special training in their task and were merely told not to be rude to the public when protecting Hitler at speaking events. He also claimed that when on guard duty at Hitler's residences, the bodyguards often had little to do and so doubled as messengers or errand boys. Perhaps because of these shortcomings, a number of uninvited visitors managed to penetrate the Reich Chancellery. All of them were intercepted, but their presence made it clear that the Chancellery was not as hermetically sealed as Hitler would have wished. Operations in the field were often just as flawed. When Hitler entered Vienna in 1938, for example, his bodyguards attempted to merge into the crowd dressed in what he described as an astonishing collection of clothes, rough woolen mackintoshes, ostlers, capes, and so forth. The urbane and sartorially sophisticated Viennese viewed them with amusement. Hitler was furious. "Any moron," he raged, "could recognize them for what they were at a glance." Perhaps for this reason, Hitler considered his bodyguards to be of only limited utility, and felt that his continued survival was due to the benign attentions of Providence. Indeed, he was notoriously impatient with his closest defenders. He had an almost visceral aversion to policemen, perhaps as a result of years of struggle, and could not bear to feel himself being watched. He would often shout at his SS patrols, "Go and guard yourselves!" In the circumstances, the overlapping spheres of competence of Hitler's numerous security organs must have proved a constant irritation. Yet this curious state of affairs was entirely of the Führer's own making. Being congenitally suspicious, he was unwilling to allow one individual to take charge of his security apparatus. And he was also keen to utilize the principle that guided many of his political machinations, that of administrative chaos. Under this system, numerous organizations and individuals would be encouraged to compete in fulfilling a single task. This competition, it was thought, bred efficiency, but it also appealed to Hitler's Darwinian ideal of the survival of the fittest. As one Nazi memoirist recalled, Hitler also liked to play his paladins off against each other. It pleased Hitler immensely to see organizations which dealt with similar issues engage in feuds with one another. For only in such circumstances, so he believed, would he be able to maintain his independence from the specialized ministries. Those who became too powerful, he gladly cut down to size. To those who were stranded out on a limb, he extended a hand and helped them back onto their feet. This practice may have been beneficial in politics, but in the security sphere it did little but sow confusion and, of course, violate the golden rule, that of making one authority solely responsible. In one instance, Hitler ordered his driver to accelerate to escape a strange car that had attached itself to his motorcade. He was, unwittingly, escaping from yet another set of his own bodyguards. The result of all this was that despite huge advances in personal safety, surveillance, and what in modern parlance one might call counter-terrorism, Hitler's security regime of the late 1930s still offered tantalizing opportunities to a would-be assassin. The regime was certainly not as refined and practiced as it would later become. and until 1938, the threats to Hitler's person remained largely theoretical. His bodyguards, lurking in the lifts and making faces in the windows, were probably bored of chasing phantoms and will-o'-the-wisps. In addition, Hitler was reveling in his overwhelming popularity. The year was studded with numerous public appearances that had become enshrined in the Nazi calendar, including the Day of the Seizure of Power in January, Hitler's birthday in April, the Bayreuth Wagner Festival in July, the Nuremberg Rally in September, and of course, the commemoration of the beer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.